From the readings of this morning, I wanted to focus a bit with you on the Pauline. The Pauline epistle of this morning, as you heard, is really the entirety of the first chapter of the epistle of St. Paul to the Galatians. This chapter presents a very important, a vital anchor for the faith. Far too often in the world, our faith is challenged. From popular media to movies. Ever watched a History Channel? They have, I don't know how many different series on the early Christians, the true Jesus, the face of Jesus. It's a cottage industry. And the movies, some blatantly attack the faith. Not too long ago, we had the whole thing with the Da Vinci Code and what have you. But in many others, even those that seem to have a Christian message, the faith is under attack. In academia, it's become very fashionable to differentiate between the early Christians. Well, actually, no, let me go back a step further. Jesus, the early Christians, the Gospels, statements of faith, and differentiating between all of these, dividing all of these as if there's no link. The whole thesis of discussing the Jesus of history versus the Christ of faith, and how long did Jesus, the man, become Christ the God. All of these come up repeatedly over and over again, and oftentimes we find ourselves, we find our children, we find our colleagues, really no more than a freshman course away from doubting our faith. It's not uncommon to find our youth as they enter college, they take intro to philosophy, intro to history, intro to religious studies, and come back with a whole host of questions that they're unable to answer. An introductory class shakes us to the foundation of our faith. Galatians, in this first chapter, provides us with an anchor. First, we need just a few preliminary remarks. And it has to do with apostleship. What does it mean to be an apostle? What is an apostle? Because as we'll see, one of the things that St. Paul keeps on coming back to throughout this epistle is whether or not he is an apostle. That's one of the attacks against him. In the scriptures, there are two basic meanings. The word means one sent. But when you read in the New Testament, it has two basic meanings. One meaning is a messenger, somebody who is commissioned, somebody who is sent. You give somebody a letter, the letter arrives through them, that person becomes a messenger, the one sent, literally. The second meaning is much more narrow. The second meaning is for the apostles of Christ, those that have seen him, not only during his life, but they must have seen him during the resurrection, after the resurrection. They must have seen the resurrected Messiah, and they must have been personally commissioned by him. Had St. Thomas not went back, had St. Thomas not seen Christ again, he could not have been an apostle, even though he saw Jesus' ministry and witnessed the ministry. But unless you have seen the resurrected Messiah, that narrow definition does not apply. It's a narrow definition that existed for a very unique period within the church. After that first generation died, there are no more apostles. We have the successors to the apostles, the bishops. And oftentimes there's a little bit of confusion, but bishops are successors to the apostles, bishops are not apostles. And if we had more time, we could kind of differentiate that a little bit more. On a very basic level, a bishop is tied to their city, to their town, where they were ordained. An apostle isn't. St. Peter went from one end of the Roman Empire to the other. He was not tied to a location. The bishops that he ordained, they have to abide in their locations. Just a kind of a basic differentiation. When we come to the Epistle of the Galatians, almost all are in unison that it was written right about roughly the year 55 or so, perhaps a little bit earlier, a few years before, a few years after. but about 20 years after the resurrection. This is as early as you get. I mean, 1 Thessalonians is a little bit earlier, but it's briefer. 20 years after the resurrection. Quickly, problems arise. St. Paul had already preached to the Galatians. The letter, this is perhaps a year, maybe two after he had preached in Galatia. The letter provides a summary of what he had preached. And in it, he rebuffs two accusations. There are two basic accusations that come against St. Paul. The first is that he's not a real apostle. As we mentioned, apostle in the narrow sense. This is someone who has seen the resurrected Christ and was commissioned by him. St. Paul admits at the time the crucifixion took place, so on and so forth, he didn't know anything about Jesus. And afterwards, when he found out about it, he persecuted the Christians. It's not till much later that he converted. So for some, it was, well, you can't really be a true apostle. You came in way late. The other accusation is that he changed his words, that he wanted to be popular, that he said to the Jews what the Jews wanted to hear, and he said to the Gentiles what they wanted to hear, to gain converts from both and to be popular with both. It's because of this, and the problems that have arisen from this, that St. Paul writes the letter to the Galatians. The opening of the letter is quite important. And here there are aspects that are unique to the Galatians, some aspects that are universal to the letters of St. Paul. It begins with Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brothers who are with me. We read it very quickly, but there's a lot here. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man. Do you see how just the introduction? He's already rebuffing the accusation. He is telling them, I'm not an apostle in that general sense where somebody sent me. I wasn't sent by Peter. I wasn't sent by James. I'm not an apostle in the normal sense. Then he becomes more explicit. But through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him. I am an apostle in that narrow sense. I am commissioned by Jesus Christ himself. And this is something he'll come back to quickly. But there's more here. There's more here. This is a very, very important passage. If you understand this passage, you understand St. Paul. Through Jesus Christ and God the Father. Who is the Jesus that his name comes before God? Through Jesus Christ and God the Father. Who is the Jesus that his commissioning is on the same par as God the Father? It doesn't make sense. In a Jewish context, this is absolute blasphemy. St. Paul was, as you have heard still in that first chapter of Galatians, he tells you he was jealous among his people. He was a Pharisee taught by the most respected rabbi of his age. This is not something accidental. And even if it was accidental here, read on in the epistle. He repeats this again and again. Read his other epistles. In every single epistle of St. Paul, he comes back with the same idea. Who is the Jesus whose name takes precedence before God and whose commissioning is on par with God? He is but God. He is but God. The opening of every one of St. Paul's letters is a theological, Christological declaration. When you hear in the media and classes and where have you that this idea of Jesus being truly divine, this is a 4th century idea. Think about Galatians 20 years after the resurrection. He doesn't use technical terminology. He is not saying, well, Jesus here is homoousios with the Father. He's not using the technical vocabulary that came in the 4th century. But look at what he is saying. He is saying that Jesus is on par with God Almighty. His commissioning is on par Almighty. His name can even come before God Almighty. Isn't that what homoousios means? If you take away all of the fancy Greek rhetoric with nature and essence and what have you, isn't that the basic idea of what it means? Remember this. Remember this. We see these bizarre programs about the Jesus of history, the Christ of faith. There's kind of a move within academia that's making its way into popular media that somehow the Gnostics, these two second, third century heretics, were the ones that got it right, and that the mainline Christians were the ones that have it all wrong. The Gnostics are spiritual, they are holy. Is these other groups that have somehow misunderstood who Jesus was? He continues. To the churches of Galatia. Sometimes when we discuss doctrine, the standard line is that doctrine is dry. It's boring. Why bother with it? I want to be a spiritual individual. I want to be a holy individual. Why bother with these doctrines and hair splitting, so on and so forth? This is exactly why you bother with it. To the churches of Galatia. In every single one of his letters, St. Paul refers to the church of the Thessalonians, to the church of God in Corinth. It's only here where they have divisions that they become churches. They're no longer part of the church, the body of Christ. They have separated themselves into congregations. The importance of doctrinal unity is that through unity, we become part of the church, the one and only church, the church that we mention in the litanies when we pray for the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. Outside of that, we simply belong to congregations, we belong to groups, we might as well belong to party planning committees. It doesn't matter. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, notice God the Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, side by side, peace issuing from them, coming from them simultaneously. Again, not the technical language, not the Greek terms that come in the 4th and 5th century, but look at the meaning, look at what is being said. In a Jewish context, this is absolute blasphemy. You get stoned for this. St. Paul is doing this quite intentionally and repeatedly. As we have said before, so now, excuse me, I skipped the verse. Who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of God the Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. We can basically spend the whole day on this verse. Christ, the Savior of humanity, notice the hour here, he is a Jew. He is of Jewish ancestry that he is very proud of. He is speaking to Gentiles. The Galatians are Gentiles, and yet he speaks of God saving them. For our sins, not only, and he gave himself up. The sacrifice of Christ on the cross, voluntary. The cause of it, our sins. All of this coming within few short verses. As we have said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches any other gospel than that you have received, let him be accursed. For do I now persuade men or God? Do I seek to please men? If I still please men, I no longer please God. Takes on that main accusation, that he is telling the Jews what they want to hear, he's telling the Gentiles what they want to hear to gain converts from both, to be popular with both, says in the most stringent manner. If you hear anything, accept what I've told you. That is to be anathema. For if I still please men, I would still be a bondservant for Christ. Pleasing God and pleasing man, that theme that runs through from Christ telling the Israelites that you cannot serve God and mammon, to here with St. Paul telling them that I cannot please men and Christ. Notice the importance here placed on teaching. If anyone preaches another gospel, let them be accursed. Another part in the scriptures tells them, don't let many of you become teachers. Teaching within the church is a major, major responsibility. Now, teaching goes on constantly, but there's a distinction between sharing an individual's opinion, an individual's perspective, versus teaching doctrine. And the church is very careful in that, in stipulating that teaching proper is only the duty of the clergy. But not all teaching has to be done by clergy, as long as it's under the supervision of clergy. And this is why within a congregation, ultimately the priest is the one who is responsible for the teaching within the congregation. If you have a youth meeting, one of the youth is speaking, that's fine, but it's under the jurisdiction of the priest. The deacon is answerable to the bishop. The priest is answerable to the bishop. The bishop is answerable to both the diocese, his congregation, and his fellow bishops. Teaching and teaching authority is limited and checked at every level. And it goes back to this basic idea. Whoever has another gospel, another message than that which is preached is accursed. They are damned. But I make known to you, my brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me, what is the gospel? St. Paul doesn't have a gospel, does he? What's the message? It's the message. Jesus Christ, the resurrected Messiah, Christ, and him crucified. But the gospel, and notice here it's in the singular, and even though we mentioned the four evangelists, and we mentioned the four gospels are really one gospel. The gospel is Christ Jesus himself. The gospel which was preached by me, not according to man, for I neither received it from a man, nor was I taught it, but it came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now this is a marvelous verse. This is a marvelous verse. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but it came to me through the revelation of Jesus Christ. How did St. Paul know the teachings of Christ? He was with him. During his ministry, in whether he was teaching the masses, whether he was only with the 12, and with St. Peter, even in the case of the Transfiguration, where there's only he, John, and Christ, and the prophet, and the lawgiver. Afterwards, the 40 days after the resurrection, Christ is there, and it explicitly says that he was there teaching the apostles about the kingdom of God. St. Paul comes in years after. He comes years afterwards. How does he know? How did he find out these things? Just go back two verses. Don't read the whole corpus of St. Paul's letters. Just go back two verses. This whole understanding, deep understanding of Christ submitting himself voluntarily for our sins in order to save us from this evil world. Where is he getting this? It came through the revelation of Jesus Christ. Many of the fathers have argued that upon his conversion, on that road to Damascus, as he fell from his horse, as he witnessed and encountered the resurrected Christ, that in that instant, he was given all the knowledge that he needed. the revelation of Jesus Christ to him, the meaning, that is how he understands. This is how he has knowledge of things that he could not have known. Through the revelation of Jesus Christ. Galatians. I've only touched on a few verses here from Galatians. But Galatians is quite important because it's very early and it's very explicit. In this world where we're constantly coming up against various bizarre ideas that challenge our faith, most of them coming in a century, 2 centuries after not only the epistles of St. Paul, but the Gospels and the entirety of the New Testament scriptures. If there is a problem within academia today, and again, the problems resonating through movies and common media and what have you, is that in many cases, just the basic fundamental tenets are not taken seriously. The earliest text always outweigh later text. If you want to understand Christianity, look at the earliest text. The earliest texts are the 27 books that we have in our Gospels. It is just simply that simple. Galatians provides us with the anchor for our faith, based in truth, truth and understanding. It is important, it is vital, it is essential for our faith to be rooted in truth and understanding. Faith that is based on emotion, faith that is based on mere acquaintance, is but a movie, a friend, a class away from doubt. May God grant us in his faith. And glory be to God forever. Amen.